So I'm just going to focus on very few things that are there in the surgical management. So whether you say that transanal endoscopic microsurgery is a surgical management, well, it's sort of a surgical and endoscopic management. So this is also a very important topic. And the other thing I would like to really focus on would be the laparoscopic surgery in management of colorectal cancer, and also surgical management of resectable colorectal metastasis, which has changed our view of this metastatic disease. And lastly, also on coloanal anastomosis and also intersphincteric resection to push the limits of sphincter preservation. So talking about colorectal cancer, it's a very common cancer. It's third in men, second most common cancer in women in the world, according to GlobalCan 2012. And when we talk about the distribution of colorectal cancer, well, it's more common in the West, where you can see that the incidence is quite high. But you also have to stress on the red line there, that is the mortality. If you compare the incidence and mortality, well, the proportion of mortality is quite low compared to the incidence. But when you go deep down, where the incidence is low, like in our part of the world, the South and Central Asia, and as well as in the African countries, though the incidence is quite low, you can see that the mortality almost equals the incidence. So we have a very high mortality in our part of the world. And also talking about the survival, well, the stage, as also what has been highlighted previously, stage 1 and stage 2 diseases, well, they have a survival of more than 90%. Stage 3, well, with adjuvant therapy, it's in and around 70%. When it is stage 4, it's around 8% only. But the matter of fact is that these are all metastatic disease. So if you take into account only those patients who are operated, who have resectable colorectal metastasis from liver or lung, then the survival is usually in and around from 25% to as high as 60%. So I'm first going to talk on the transanal endoscopic microsurgery. So this has been the treatment of choice for large benign lesions and also an option for well-selected malignant lesions, and it precludes major and very morbid resections like abdominal peritoneal resections, and also it would in some way avoid a permanent stoma in patients who are undergoing EPR. I think in our practice, almost everyone would have had patients, when you counsel them for an EPR, they usually don't come back, okay? Or you prefer to go to some other surgeons just in the hope that somebody might tell you that you're not going to require a permanent stoma. So that's how devastating it is for the patients. And also that TEM is preferred because of better visibility, because we work in the magnification and you also have a large confined space. You're going to create a new peritoneum there. So there's going to be a space where you can work, you can clearly see the margins, okay? So in that aspect, it's going to be better. Obviously, when you have a better visibility, then your complications rate would be decreased. So TEM, basically how is it done? It is a 40 mm diameter rectoscope, which may be either 12 to 20 or 20 centimeters in length. And at the surgeon's end, there is this glass shield, means the gas-tight face piece, which seals so that the pneumoperitoneum doesn't leak. And it has basically four ports, one for the camera, three are the working ports. So this is how it would look like. So you have this the camera port, okay, and then these are the working ports. And once you assemble all the instruments, it look like this. And you can also see that it's not very clear, but this the working instrument need to be with the articulation, like what we use for sills, okay? Because this working angle is very narrow, so you won't be able to work when there are no articulating forceps. So this study by Winde et al. Showing that TEM and anti-resection, they evaluated on G1 T2 tumors of T1 tumors, and they showed that there was no the significant difference in favor of TEM was in terms of hospitalization, blood loss, operating time, and opioid analgesia, and there was no difference in the local recurrences as well as survival. So this had shown that the TEM was superior. On the other end, like another study, this on T1 tumors showed that again safety in terms of all these immediate parameters, mortalities was lower on in TM group, and also overall survival was also comparable. But the thing to note is that the local recurrence in their series after TM was 24%, with regards to 0% with TM. Okay, so you have to be very cautious. You have the because for that reason. The preoperative evaluation is very important, because if there is any node positive disease, there is in fact no role of TEM being performed. So, though T1 lesions are said to be more favorable for TEM, then what about the T2 diseases? Well, this study on comparing T1 and T2 diseases for TEM as well as in with radical surgery, you can see that the TEM group had more of the T1 lesions, so they had selected more of T1 lesions, whereas in the other group, that is the radical surgery group, you can see that most of them were T2 group. So there was a selection bias, but with no statistical difference between the TM and radical group in T1 cancers was present. But for T2 cancers, like there was the higher local recurrence. However, there was no difference in survival, 5-year survival between these two groups. So another important aspect, as Dr. Simit has already highlighted, is that there's a very important role of giving neoadjuvant chemotherapy, chemoradiotherapy for low rectal, mid rectal cancers. Okay. So what if we tend to give neoadjuvant therapy and subject these patients for TEM, including both T1 and T2 diseases? Like in this study, there were these patients and T2 lesions were all subjected for neoadjuvant therapy, radio chemotherapy. In this, after 97-month follow-up, we could see that local recurrences occurred in 4 patients, and metastatic disease, systemic metastasis in 2 patients. All of these were in the T2 group. And there was also a slight benefit in the survival in patients who had T1, but again for T2 also, this disease-free survival of 93 was also good. So, taking all these things into mind, so you probably say that T1 would be really those who would really benefit. For T2, you have to be very highly selective. So the next thing for us as surgeons would be, well, what would you do? Would you go for a laparoscopic surgery, or would you go for a open surgery? So initial series of laparoscopic surgery, this one in 1991, so a series of 20 patients where most of the resections, as you can see, were right hemicolectomies and sigmoid colectomies, which are considered to be easy. In comparison to, let's say, LAR. So when they concluded by saying that it's a potential to be as popular as laparoscopic cholecystectomy. I don't know whether it is as popular as laparoscopic cholecystectomy, but definitely it is gaining popularity. But again, there are some issues. There were some issues at that time that were planned to be addressed as well. So one was regarding port site recurrence. So in 35 patients of laparoscopic cholecystectomy, they found that there was port site recurrence, and their conclusion was that like for laparoscopic resection, you have to be very careful. So they didn't straight away say that it should not be contemplated, but they used the word of caution. So another important aspect also is learning curve. Okay, so it's not as easy to master laparoscopic colorectal surgery. So how many do you need to perform? So this study was done comparing like the high volume and low volume surgeons. The cutoff was 40. So what did they find? There was similar conversion rate, length of hospital stay, but there were lower rates of intra and post-operative complications when the high volume surgeons operated. So even now, like when all these laparoscopic trials are being met, like they have a certain criteria. Like one of the very important trial that I will be coming across in the next slide is the COST trial. Okay, so in this trial, a surgeon, for him to be eligible to participate in the trial, he should have performed at least 20 surgeries and also submit a video demonstrating the correct technique. Okay, so it was quite stringent. So all these benefits. Okay, so these benefits are there with laparoscopic surgery, including post-operative IDS, reduced pain, decreased analgesia, and also shorter length of hospital stay, and also improved cosmetic improvements, or whether there are these drawbacks which are really hampering laparoscopic surgery in terms of long operating times, expensive equipment, and port site recurrence, as well as a long operating curve. Well, there was a necessity for randomized control trials. Without these trials, you are not going to be able to tell whether one is superior over the other. So these landmark trials, the first, as I said, is the COST trial. That's the clinical outcome of surgical therapy trial, including multicenter trial of 48 institutions of 872 patients performed by credentialed surgeons. So they found that rectal cancer, recurrent cancer was similar after both laparoscopic and open surgery. And they concluded that it is an acceptable alternative to open surgery for colon cancer. So another very important trial is what is the SCOLAR trial, this colon cancer laparoscopic or colon resection trial, where 3-year survival was comparable, 72% and 76%, and 3-year disease-free survival and 3-year overall survival was also comparable. This MRC classic trial which randomized in 1:2 open versus laparoscopic, so 53 and 484 patients. Amazingly, in that trial, like conversion rate was quite high, but difference in C2 tumors and also intra-hospital mortality basically was not different. Colon cancer was found to be superior to in laparoscopic group. However, they had a high positive margins in the low anterior resection group. So this also had to be addressed, and this basically was addressed by the Korean team. So they did this Korean trial where they performed randomized open versus laparoscopic surgery in mid and low rectal cancers after neoadjuvant therapy. And they had 170 patients in each arm. And so there was involvement of CRM, macroscopic quality of the TME specimen, number of nodes harvested, perioperative morbidity was not different between the two groups. And so laparoscopic surgery was safe in short-term outcome, as well as there was the quality of oncological resection was also equivalent. So with this, Cochrane review of all these, most of these trials, 33 randomized trials were identified, where only 12 of them were eligible, and which included 3,000 plus patients, where the occurrence of hernias, their surgery for hernias was not significant, and the rate of recurrence at primary tumor was also similar, and there's no difference between the port site and wound recurrences and the cancer-related mortality, and no significant difference in tumor resection. This is what was concluded upon. So when we talk about laparoscopic surgery, the next order, like the upcoming thing, is the robotic surgery. So we have to also take a word of whether robotic surgery has any advantage over the laparoscopic surgery. So this systematic review and meta-analysis of 300 plus patients in both groups showed that the robotic surgery group had a lower conversion rate, however the operating time was higher. So perioperative mortality, circumferential resection margin, and lymph nodes clearance was similar. So talking about surgical management of resectable colorectal metastasis, well, 20 to 25% of the patients have detectable colorectal metastasis, and of these, 20 to 30% are resectable. If you don't operate them, with the supportive care only, the survival is between 2.3 to 32 months, obviously along with chemotherapy as well. And liver resection is the only treatment that can cure, and 5-year survival, as I said, is between 25 to 60%. So there are various factors we need to take upon. This is presence of symptoms, location of primary tumor, extent of tumor, and also the patient's performance status. So as you can see from the NCCN guidelines, that the weightage for doing surgery first or giving chemotherapy first has been given as equal weightage. So there has not been a consensus saying that this one form of treatment is superior over the other. For rectal cancer, colon cancer, and similar also for the rectal cancer. So controversies for stage and synchronous resection. We want to resect both the things at once or we want to resect one after the other. Well, the points would be whether it is safe and short-term outcome is better, one is better over the other, and also the long-term oncological outcome. So when you do a stage resection, well, it's resection, chemotherapy followed by liver resection. So in patients with those who would really require the primary lesion being tackled first, obviously in those patients who have acute symptoms or like emergency setting where there's GI bleeding, obstruction, perforation, there's no doubt that the patients first would require resection of the primary tumor. Also in frail patients who would probably not withstand the simultaneous resection. And this stage resection also would be a test of time where you would identify those patients after resection of the colon where there is a rapid progression of the tumors in the liver, then those are the patients who would probably not benefit from surgical therapy of the means the liver surgery. So historically these synchronous lesions were viewed with skepticism, like simultaneous resection 6.9% versus stage resection 2.5% was the mortality. And but with time, like when the surgeons have been better doing liver surgeries and also the advances in anesthesia and perioperative care, this has really been possible. And the advantage again of synchronous resection would be one hospital stay, one operation, and also initiation of this adjuvant therapy would be earlier. So this study on simultaneous versus stage resection, well, morbidity and mortality was comparable. However, shorter hospital stay was there in the simultaneous group when you take into account the addition of both the hospital stays. And similarly, the perioperative mortality was zero in both groups in this study, and morbidity was higher in the stage group. And postoperative complication, in especially when there's large volume of liver that was resected, then in that case the stage resection was better. So again, simultaneous resection for colorectal cancer metastasis is 65% of the patients had simultaneous resection, 22% had delayed resection, and the 3-year survival was similar. So this also what is called as a reverse or a liver first approach, where you tend to resect do the preoperative chemotherapy followed by resection of liver metastasis, and then you resect the colorectal primary. The rationale for this approach is that usually complications with the primary tumor are usually rare, though they tend to occur, but they are usually rare, especially when they are identified early. And also treatment of metastatic disease is not delayed by the local therapy, because after local therapy, like you do the LRR or something, there may be some other complications which may delay the chemotherapy. So combining, doing the conventional approach, classic approach combined, or the reverse strategy, this study showed that all these outcomes were similar, and reverse strategy could be an alternative option. So last, talking about this colanal anastomosis and intrasphincteric resection, it's very important that how much can we go down? Like initially in the 80s, it was that the distal margin should be 5 centimeters. Then it has come down to 2 centimeters. With this study, like, is this 1 centimeter distal margin adequate? So in this systematic review, you could see that less than 1 centimeter margin and more than 1 centimeter margin after neoadjuvant chemo radiation, the local recurrence was higher only by 1%, and which was not statistically significant. So in conclusion, less than 1%, 1 centimeter margin did not jeopardize the oncological safety. So if you have more than 1 centimeter of stump from the levator ana, you can do a stapled anastomosis. If not, handstone, soon coloanal anastomosis. Very low tumors, you can subject them for intrasphincteric resection as well. So this is the picture that is depicting the stapled anastomosis, which we usually tend to do. And when you have the Hansen anastomosis, you tend to bring down the pouch, and you're going to do Hansen anastomosis. And just talking about the intrasphincteric resection, there are also three types of intrasphincteric resection. So if you are going to go at the level of the dented line. Okay, so this would the partial type, and if you are going to go and going to include the whole of the internal sphincter, then it would be the total type, and if it is in between, it would be the subtotal type. Just about sphincter preservation in lower rectal cancers, in these patients of 1 to 48 patients, you could see that all patients underwent neoadjuvant chemo radiation, and 57% of these patients had sphincter preservation, and 63 patients underwent APR. And the thing was that there was circumferential positive margin in 2 patients out of 44 in intersphincter group resection, and 8 out of 30, 63 in APR group. And the survival was also superior in the staple group and the intersphincter group. However, it is worth mentioning that in this series, there was not a randomized studies, because and most of the patients in the APR group had larger tumors, they were older patients and were not responding to neoadjuvant chemo radiation. So you cannot correctly say that these are truly representative. And this study of oncological outcome and functional outcome these patients after intersphincter resection, you could see that like mean stool frequency was 4.7 per day, and 38 patients were suffering from stool fragmentation. 23% had nocturnal defecation. About 1/3 of the patients required antidiarrheal medication. But overall, when you compare the common and stroma, more than 90% of the patients were satisfied with their functional results of surgery. So after total rectal resection, so to prevent these all types of problems with defecation, you can either use a colonic pouch or a coloplasty. So this is how you do a colonic pouch and also the coloplasty, where you make a longitudinal incision and you are going to suture them transversely. So meta-analysis on this colonic reservoirs versus straight colon resection, like it shows that there is significant reduction of frequency of defecation with J-pouch compared to the straight anastomosis. And fecal urgency was also better, less prevalent with J-pouch, and there's no difference in functional outcome between the J-pouch and the coloplasty anastomosis. So to conclude, TEM is a suitable for treatment of T1 tumors without nodal metastasis, and also in patients, highly selected patients in T2 tumors. Laparoscopic resection of colorectal tumors has become a standard of care, with comparable long-term as well as short-term as well as long-term outcomes to open surgery. And there has been a shift in paradigm in management of colorectal cancer metastasis from palliative treatment to potentially curative treatment, and also decreasing the distal tumor margin and use of intraspective resection has made it possible to avoid permanent stoma even in lower rectal tumors. Thank you.